gonna reveal, who's gonna believe what is gonna come out of this, is that you actually get salvation from this. But if you look at it from humanism, secular humanism, mental ascent, you're gonna miss it. You're not gonna see that your sins were paid for. Your sickness was paid for. You're not going to see that he was beaten and broken down for you physically in front of the world on the earth on a cross, which is called a place of cursing. You're going to see that. Can you see that he did this so that you could be well? Ooh, that agony of his mind that those beatings gave him so that you could have mental peace. He took all the mental anguish, torment, stress, anxiety, right there, experienced it so that you don't have to experience it. So what I'm saying, anything that we experience negatively about our total being is because we have relented to it. Well, that's heavy, but that's reality. And you look at Isaiah 53, it tells you, somewhere in there, 53, maybe it's verse 3, 4, or 5, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was, so what does it say? I've got my, okay.
Study of verse 4.
Verse 4, okay, okay.
Surely he has borne our griefs, okay. He carried our sorrows, okay. And yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted.
Mm-hmm.
But he was wounded for our transgressions,
mm-hmm.
He was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed.
That's right. And then, that's okay.
By his stripes.
And then sometime, we fast forward, that there was a man over in the book of Acts, and verse, you fast forward into our day, Acts the 8th chapter, not our day, but into a farther time period.
And did you say Acts 8?
Uh-huh, Acts 8. And there was a man reading what we just got through reading in the book of Acts. There's a man reading what we just got through reading. He was reading some this writing that Isaiah wrote. He happened to be reading it. And I'm going to go with verse Acts 8 and 26. And a disciple happened to be in the area. His name was Philip. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, arise and go toward the south. Until the way go down from Jerusalem into Gaza, and that place is desert. He arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopian, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, queen of Ethiopia, who had the charge of all her treasure. This man had, he was a treasurer of Candace's business, and he came to Jerusalem to worship. Verse 28. He was returning, and he was sitting in his chariot. He was on his trip. How many take a trip, airplane, train, and you pick up something and you read it? But it ain't nothing but the little airplane book, that magazine book. But you read something. USA Today, pick it up and read it. Then he says, he's reading. And he's reading. It happened to be the same thing that Isaiah, we read in Isaiah. He was returning and sitting in his chariot, and he read Isaiah the prophet. And then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join that guy in that chariot. And Philip ran there to him and heard him read prophet Isaiah and said, and Philip said to him, do you understand what you're reading? And that takes us back to Isaiah 53. This, who's going to believe this? Who can believe this stuff that Isaiah saw in a vision? And then it actually happened. And he says, how can someone come to believe in this? And so Philip asked this guy, do you understand what you're reading? And the guy said, how can I accept some man, what, guide me? And then verse 32, the place of the scripture which he read, he was led as a slaughter, like a lamb, dumb before his shear. So opened not he his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who should declare his generation? His life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and says, I pray thee, of whom speak the prophet? Of himself? Or some other man. Is he writing about himself? Who is he writing about?
Jesus.
That's right. And that's what it took for that eunuch who was reading that, like it was just a daily paper. What is this? So you have to get this spiritual understanding as well as the mental. Jesus hung on the cross. That's the Easter story. He died. Amen. Let's go get the Easter bunnies and the eggs. No, hold up. That's not the story. Hold up. Jesus died, and he was buried, and he rose again. What's in that for you? That's who's going to believe this report. What's in that for you? And people that don't believe that they're reading it from, it's like they're reading a daily newspaper or something. They're not getting it. You need to get it, what it's doing for you spiritually. So now we're going to, let's look at the evidence that he actually rose again. It's a tangible, on-the-earth proof, on-the-earth evidence that Jesus actually rose again. Yes, sir.
When I was reading John this morning, I read something that was referring to what we're reading right now. When Thomas didn't actually believe it happened to Jesus, Jesus came in there. Mm-hmm. Jesus said, put your hand in my wound and mm-hmm. prove it. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. then at the end of it, he said, blessed are those who believe without seeing me.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's
but he said, the only reason why he believed was because he showed up.
That's right. Hallelujah. That's a good observation there. Yeah. Okay. So let's look at our lesson today and see what we got here. All right. If someone dies, anybody ever go visit the grave? Anybody ever?
Yeah.
Memorial. Anybody ever go visit the grave? What are you gonna do? Pull a cow poop off. Can pull up a weed. What are you doing here? What are you doing here, Sister Shirley?
So are you saying what
you? I didn't say. I just want to know what you're doing.
Every year.
Okay.
I go to bed. Okay. Yes, I do. I've always done it.
Okay.
Go clean them off.
Now immediately after funeral, when they ain't been in there too long, you ever do that? Just go,
talk with them.
Yeah, been a week, been a month, a couple of days. Let me go, just go to the graveyard.
Yeah,
just some folks do that. So it ain't nothing new.
Find peace there.
Yeah, it ain't nothing new. People do that. Sometimes people are strange, but they do so. All right, so here we go. John 20:1. Here we go. The first day of the week, this is the first day of the week, cometh Mary Magdalene, this is in John 20:1, when it was dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. All right, now we see that she done that. Let's look at some other accounts, because this is John's account. Let's look at some other reporters. Look at the Wall Street Journal, USA. Tulsa World. That's what these guys. They're just different. They're just reporting it from a different viewpoint. If I tell a story, she'll say it different. Same story. He'll say it come out the same way. He tell the same story, but say it a little bit different or something. So you say maybe add something out, leave something out. So let's see what somebody else said about this. Matthew 28:1. Telling the same story. We're gonna look at several people telling the same story. All right, anybody got 28:1? And read the first two verses, if you will.
Okay. Early on Sunday morning, mm-hmm. as the new day was dawning,
yeah.
Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Mm-hmm. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, mm-hmm. and sat on it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's good. Now, so John said, we just read what John said, the first day of the week, come Mary, and he didn't mention nobody else. Here, Matthew, same story, he mentioned Mary and
the other Mary.
Mm-hmm. It's the same story. So, all right, so one guy said Mary, the other guy said Mary and somebody else. All righty, let's look at Mark 16. While you're there in Matthew, look at 27:56. While you're there. Okay. You're still there? Look at the close to verse 1, chapter 27, verse 56. Mm-hmm. Okay, someone read verse 56, if you will, please.
Among which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James, and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children.
Wait a minute. We had one guy just sent one person, another guy, he's got a pretty much of a crowd coming in here to see this, went to the same grave. And Mary the mother, and they identify Mary the mother of James, Joseph's, Zebedee's children, the mother of Zebedee's children. Yeah, all these people right here, last week, or the week before, we talked about Jesus gathering up his team. Well, he gathered up his team, but those team members had mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, and uncles and everybody else, you know, and some of them came to be followers.
Well, it actually says in 55, you know, many women were there
okay.
watching from a distance.
Yeah.
And they had followed yeah. Jesus from Galilee to yeah. care for his needs.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of a bit of a crowd. And Mark 16 and 1, if you will. Okay, everybody got that one? Someone read it if you got that. See who's same story.
16 and 1.
Same story. Going to the same grave.
And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James mm-hmm. and Solomon,
Salonium,
had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him.
Okay, now, and when was this done? It says in verse 2. What time of day? When was it done?
Very early on Sunday.
And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came into the sepulcher at the rising of the sun. So we got Mary, we got Salome. Who is she? She is one of the mothers of one of the disciples. Okay, she's one of the mothers of one of the disciples. And so really it was more than just Mary Magdalene going to that grave. If you just stopped at Matthew's book and read it, you thought she was the only one going to the graveyard. Mm-hmm. But now there was a lot of going to the graveyard. And that's what we'll be doing on Memorial, whatever day Memorial is. Sister Shirley will be on the highway. Burning up gas, going out to the graveyard. Going to the graveyard. Where's Shirley? To the graveyard. Why is she going? She's going to look. She's going to look. She's going to take a look. Okay. Okay, we're going to take a look. Okay. So it's been going on for years. All right. Some other verses is Luke 24 and 1, Luke 23 and 55. And we'll look at 23 and 55 and we'll go on. Luke 23 and 55. And let's see. Who went this time? Might find Shirley in here. Okay, what does it say, Sister Shirley?
23:55. And the women also which came with him from Galilee followed after, and behold the sepulchre and how his body was laid.
Okay. All right. And, verse 56, please.
And they returned and prepared spices and ornaments and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment.
Okay, so the women went. They wanted to see how his body was laid. Take a look. So they saw, and said, okay, we'll be back. Because the Jewish holiday of the Sabbath day was approaching, and they know that they had to don't do nothing until the next sunrise.
So it's also their custom to prepare the body with spices.
And they beat him up, hung him on the cross like mincemeat, and just threw him in the grave. They did not do what the customary thing was to do, prepare the body for the grave, clean it up,
wrap it up good, and
keep it from stinking and all that. They just threw him in there. Mm. Mm. So they came and looked and saw that's how it was and said, well, we don't have time to do what we need to do. The Sabbath is approaching, so we got to get on back, and then we'll come as soon as the Sabbath is over. And they didn't wait till half the day that the Sabbath was over. As soon as the Sabbath was over, they took out to get that body prepared for what it was supposed to be, what it's supposed to be laid. Those scoundrels, they just beat him up, killed him, and threw him in there. And so they said, we're going to come back and at least give him a proper burial. People say that, going to give him a proper burial. So here they come back. And that's verse 2 of St. John the 20th chapter. Verse 2, that's where we pick up our lesson. They're on their way back.
Okay. And cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulcher, and we know not where they have laid him.
And where they have laid him. And so Peter therefore went forward, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulcher. Peter and John was hanging out. Actually, hiding out.
That was
hiding. They killed him. Hey, we guess who's next?
Yeah.
So we hiding. They hiding. Peter a little bit older. John young. And John and Jesus had a real, if you want to call it best, but this is my ace. This is my main man. That's how John was to Jesus. This is my main man right here. So he was the younger one of all of the disciples, and him and Jesus was kind of bonded closer than the other ones did. So, and when Jesus was dying on the cross, he told John, take care of Mom. You know, he said, Mom, John is going to take care of you from now on. He's dying, and he's suffering. He looks down. He says, he sees his mom crying and going on. He says, John, take care of Mom. Make sure Mom's all right. That's his humanity. Why he shows us his humanity. Somebody take care of Mom. Now, where was Dad? I don't know at that time. Don't say too much about him. Where was he? Maybe he already died. Mm-hmm. Who knows? But he had a large family of kids through Mary. Mm-hmm. But he maybe he had died by then, so he had to turn Mary over to somebody. Take care of Mom. All right. So then so that's why John and Peter they had now. So Peter jumps up and said, "What? He jumped up out of anger. What more could they do to him? So he running and he ran toward the graveyard. John caught up with him, and verse 4, they both ran together. The other disciple did what? Outran the old man. Outran the old man. And he came back. Kind of like Shirley, speeding down 75. Gotta get to that graveyard. More days over. Where you ain't going? I'm gonna take a look. Take a look. Take how much? 350 gallons. Take a look. He's stooping. He's stooping down, yo. Looked in. Saw the linen clothes lying. Yet he wasn't in those clothes. He saw he stooped down. That was John. Looking in. He ain't too, looks like, you know, show him just walking on in. I kind of what's going on in here, you know. Shirley wants to get in there, so she take a look. She getting in. She wants to see. She came all this way to take a seat. So, come to see. Alright, verse 6, I'm going to help us out. We're going to let Shirley in so she can get this lesson. They don't want to go in there. Where are you going? I need to move. All right. Verse 6. Right. Somebody read verse 6.
Then comes Simon Peter, following him, and ran into the sepulcher to see the linen clothes lying.
All right. Here comes the evidence. We saw the clothes laying there. What clothes? The napkin. There was around his head. Not laying. And the napkin was not with the rest of the clothes. The clothes is over here, and the napkin is somewhere else. What? But wrapped together in a place by itself. What in the world is going on here? That's what Peter and them look at.
My Bible has said that the linen was folded up.
Oh, okay. All right.
Neat with it.
In the world. So they went, verse 8. Someone read that, please. Very important verse here.
Then the disciple mm-hmm. who had reached the tomb first also went in, mm-hmm. and he saw and believed.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then went in also that other disciple. Mm-hmm. See, Peter dashed in. He's like, sure, I got to see what's going on. Well, other guy like me, he taking a look. He finally went in. Shirley said, "Hey, anybody in here with some clothes and everything folded up nice and neat and everything's cool." So I said, "Okay, I'll go in." But Shirley was happening. Now I'm in there. I don't see what's going on.
But that goes along with Peter's personality.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Peter was going to head first, act first, think later. You know? So that's what Peter did. And the other guy, he's checking it out. He's giving it mental assent. He's trying to figure this out. And then that's why it said there that in verse 8, then went in also that other disciple which came first to the sepulcher, because he beat Peter. Mm-hmm. And he saw and believed. Now what we have here is that he went, John did, I'm not even too sure about this. He's peeping. Yeah, I ain't too sure about all this business, looking at folks in here, you know. And so, it's just the clothes, Peter said, just the clothes. So that's okay, he coming in, I'm checking it out, and ain't too sold on this stuff yet. And then he's seen the way stuff was, and the Greek word here is that his seeing is bringing him into believing. First look, I ain't gonna believe. I'm running out here, but I have to see this guy, but I ain't. He's somewhere around here. But then he looks stuff over, looks at the evidence, and the evidence convinces him to start believing. He's coming into believing. Now, remember when Jesus walked after he had risen and he was eating? And they said, "Give me some of that to eat." After he had risen, you know. And they said, "Who is this guy?" You know. He said, "What's going on?" I said, "Where you been? You've been on the rock? You don't know that they crucified that guy on the cross?" Asking us all these. And then Jesus unbraided them. In other words, he fussed them out because of their unbelief. So John is not really into that deep of believing. He's believing that, "Boy, they brought me down here and I'm seeing it. I'm getting there. I'm believing. I'm getting there." Because of, like the brother said, he what? Saw. He got to have some seeing to start getting there. And he said earlier that blessed is the one that don't see and believe. And Peter was into it. "I don't see him. That's good enough for me." He said he would. But John was like, "I'm coming into believe. Well, I ain't there yet." I mean, know some people like that. They itching that way. I'm getting there, but I ain't quite. I'm getting there, but you get me convinced, but I ain't thoroughly convinced. Yes, sir.
That kind of hurts me hearing the story about what Jesus had to go through, more for us, you know. It made me feel bad about myself, all bad I've been doing and stuff, and this man gonna shed blood for me.
Yeah.
So at first he met him, I feel bad.
Yeah,
him dying for me.
Absolutely. So there we go. So he's coming into believing. Verse 9, "For as yet they knew not the," they did not know the what?
Scripture.
"That he must rise again from the dead." They don't know the scripture yet. They're just caught in the mix of it. And as I was studying this, Hebrews 11:1 says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, evidence not seen." See, so here, and we got evidence. Napkin over here, clothes over there. Evidence. He ain't here. That's pretty easy. He ain't here. I'm coming into believing. But our belief system says we walk by faith, not by sight. So you see, John was by sight believing. I'm believing. Okay, yeah, well, hey, he ain't here. You know? It's not enough to give me resurrection believing power, but he ain't here. I'm going to give you that much right now. He ain't here. I ain't going to fuss with you, Peter. He ain't here. Let's go. Shirley, let's go. You know, get back on the highway. Let's go.
For him, that was spoken more out of fear, I guess, because, you know, if they take Jesus, then they're surely coming after
He wasn't in resurrection believer.
Right.
Then, so that's what people would read that as. He's into resurrection. And he's not in resurrection believer. He's believing that he ain't here. Okay, let's go, Shelly. Shelly want to hang around. Let's go. I ain't going to argue with you. He ain't here.
It's really interesting. Truly, it's a goodie here.
She wants to hang around and preach a little bit. Come on, let's go. Get back in the car. Okay, so our faith says faith is the substance of things. Now, faith is something that is hopeful, the evidence of things not seen. So, Peter was there. That's good enough for me. He's risen. John was there. Ah, okay, I agree with you. He ain't here. Let's go. So, we walk by faith, not by what? Sight. Okay, all right. Now, let's go to verse 10. Then the disciples went away until they were what? Home. Now the story's out. He ain't in there. Something's going on. Man, what's up? I don't know. Everybody said, I don't know. What's up? Ask Shelly. She knows. I don't know. Can you explain that? Can you explain this? Napkin over there, clothes over here. Brother said, neatly folded up, everything. And then who opened up that grave? Who moved that big old stone out the way?
I think it was an angel, I think.
Yeah, did you feel that earthquake last night, Peter? Yeah, I felt that. I ain't thinking nothing of it. We heard earthquakes all the time around here. These mountains, you don't think nothing of it. But that angel came through and caused an earthquake, caused that stone to move. Everybody else, this stuff's happening. Who cares? You know, it happens all the time. A thunderstorm in Oklahoma? Who's getting up to look at the thunderstorm? Come on. Got nothing else wrong. I'm going to sleep. That's what he was doing. I'm sleeping. But that thunderstorm, that earthquake, was something going on. Okay, and then verse 19, someone help me out there, please.
Because on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you.
Peace, and now see, why would he say peace first? Why would he say that? Don't be scared.
Calm down.
Yeah, calm down. Why would he say that? Well,
well, he told you he was going to come, though.
But who ever seen a dead man alive again?
Well,
we see on TV, we laugh when someone rises up out of the casket, everybody clear out of the church. You know? Yeah, I thought you was glad I'm back.
No, we ain't glad you're back.
We wanted to come visit you in the grave. What are you doing up here? So we ain't used to that kind of stuff. So everybody clear out. They scared. And for us, not only are they scared of the Jews, but they're scared of this guy that's just who. Whoa. You know, whoa! So he gives them assurance of, don't be scared. Slow down. Settle down, y'all. And it would nowadays, if you pray for the sick and they come back, then they just left, spirit left, and you pray for them, and the spirit come back in the body, they get up. Man, the doctor had them written off, tubes going through their nose and everything, they were breathing and stuff, and we prayed for him, he came back. Hey, we take that as what? Well, let's go get a glass of water. Go get something to eat, have dinner, have lunch. No big deal. But back then, when somebody come back from the dead, it's like, woo, that never happened before. Especially if he come pay us a visit. What is it?
I thought it was what condition was the volume. Coming back.
I hope we got time to deal with that. The brother said, he said, touch my side, look at my hands.
The whole.
Yeah. Now, question for the client. So, is it a spiritual body, or was it a body like yours?
Spiritual.
Question for the class. Was it a spiritual body or was it a body like yours? And why do you say it was a spiritual body? And why was it a body like mine? I mean, it's close to mine. If it was a spirit,
they done ran out of that wherever they were.
Because they would have spoke, would not seen.
They would have been a ghost. Mm-hmm. They thought it was a ghost. He says, touch me, handle me, you see, this is me. This is me. It was a human body. Now, it was a resurrected human body. If it was a resurrected spiritual body, you and I would be in some deep trouble. because we could not identify with that. And we couldn't share in that. But he says, this is me that was here on earth with you. I was beaten up, like it said in Isaiah 52, and I was thrown in that grave and buried in that grave, and I suffered for you, messed up like that, but I come back whole like this. I mean, you can see where the scars went in, but there's no pain, there's no nothing. I'm in a resurrected human body.
But wouldn't that kind of like clarify to everybody that is getting this that it was true? I mean,
that should have solidified. This is him. When we saw him die, we saw him get beat. We saw all of that. Now we are seeing him 100% whole. After all that, 100% whole, this is a resurrection body. Never been seen before. Never experienced it. Nothing like this before. But he says, it's me.
Yeah.
I don't think they even realized it was the Lord until he showed them the evidence.
No. Why? Because it was in unbelief.
Right.
That was in unbelief.
That's strengthening.
He ain't in the grave, but, Peter says, well, I'm believing that he's risen. John said, well, okay, he ain't here. Let's go home. You can simply eat. And then he pops in, and they're like, whoa! And they said, look at me, examine me. And they did. And even Thomas, we hear about how Thomas says, I'm with you now. I'm with you now.
Yeah.
I'm with you now. Jesus says, come on, man. You still in carnality. You still, you ain't there all the way. You got to not see me like I am and believe. And he's putting all over to them because you got to preach it like that. You're just a few. You're just a privileged crowd to see me.
Right.
About 500, 700 people are going to be privileged to see me at my resurrection. Now let's go back over to Peter. 1 Corinthians 15 chapter. Who was the last disciple to have that privilege to see Jesus in his bodily form after his resurrection? The 15, let's start with verse 7. Yeah, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 7. After that, he was seen of James, and then all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me, also, as one born out of due time. Who was that? That's Paul saying this. I saw him as one, in other words, I saw him further down the road. They saw him real close to that event, but it was some time later that I saw him. And where did I see him? On my road to Damascus, he knocked me off my horse. And I saw him, and I knew exactly who he was when I saw him. He needed no introduction. I knew exactly who he was. And I said, and Paul says, oh Lord, what do you want me? What are you coming to me for? That was Paul's question. Oh Lord, what are you coming to me for? So he says, verse 9, for I am the least of the apostles. They have not met or fit or deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all. I outworked all of the other apostles. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, so we preach and so we believe. So Paul is saying, I'm the last one to see that resurrected body of Jesus Christ. Bam!
Has anybody else done it since Paul? No. X out. And someone come to you saying that they have, X it out. Exit out. Let's call it false. Exit out. Exit out. Now they might have seen Jesus in a vision, some angel, angel visitation, right? But that resurrected body of Jesus Christ, like they saw then, no. According to the what? Scripture. Somebody come to you, I saw Jesus yesterday, he told me.
I heard that a lot.
Yeah.
That's not true.
Yeah, people jump on that bandwagon because this man seen Jesus. Hey, we're going with a winner. Hey, exit out.
Mary Magdalene and the other people that went to his grave, they missed the greatest opportunity to witness Jesus rise because of their unbelief.
Because of their unbelief. That's right.
Because Jesus went about doing work in the Sabbath.
And they could have done it.
And they could have done it. They could have just done it.
That's right.
But their unbelief caused them in this.
Yeah.
John say,
I'm with you. You going in there, Shirley.
I got your back.